Thank you. Thanks to the organizer to allow me to highlight the advances we have made in amyloidosis. Here are my disclosure. I will talk mainly on AL amyloidosis. In this disease, there is always a monoclonal B cells, usually a plasma cells, which produce immunoglobulin, monoclonal immunoglobulin, with, in general, an excess of free light chain. This free light chain form oligomers and a very organized fibrils. And the pentraxin serum amyloid protein, the SAP, have a high affinity to this fibril. This fibril deposits in the intercellular space of the organ. They fix the Congo red, and it allows to do the diagnosis, and it gives a lot of clinical feature. If we look at the cells, the monoclonal cells, it's mainly plasma cells, and usually you have an IgG, IgA, or free light chain only in about 50% of patients, but you have also in less than 10% other B-cell proliferation, and you have an IgM. What is important is usually the patient have an MGUS or smoldering myeloma. Crop criteria are very uncommon. There is a very low proliferative index, and evolution to symptomatic multiple myeloma is very rare. And recently, it has been shown that if clonal plasma cell in AL have similar phenotypic and genotypic profile than in myeloma, their transcriptome is very similar to the one of normal plasma cell. So we can say that AL amyloidosis is MGCS, as presented very nicely this morning by Jean-Paul Fermont. The light chain is usually lambda, and some genes are frequently used, and they drive the organ tropism of the disease. And what is important is that amyloid light chain form oligomers that circulate in the blood, inducing TPA activation and fibrinolysis, and they are toxic for the earth. Increasing oxidant stress, increasing reactive radicals localized to the mitochondria. And cardiac amyloidosis is much more severe than TTR amyloidosis, and you can have a rapid improvement of cardiac disease after hematologic response. Like in this patient with a very severe cardiac and a renal amyloidosis, and as you see, with a complete, rapid, complete hematologic response, the NT-proBNP drops from more than 30,000 to less than 5,000 in less than 4 months. It's very rapid. And interestingly, in this patient, and it's not usual, the kidney disease have a very rapid improvement with an albumin going from less than 15 to a quasi normal albumin in less than 1 year. So you have to diagnose amyloidosis doing the Congo red with, if possible, a non-invasive biopsy. But you have to know that one-third of patients doesn't have AL amyloidosis. It's AA in 11% of cases in Italy. I think in developed countries the same. It's much more in low-income countries. And the problem is to diagnose hereditary form. And another form that is more and more recognized is senile amyloidosis. Senile amyloidosis is deposition of wild-type TTR in the heart of aged man, and it's very frequent. After 80 years, at autopsy, there is amyloid fibril in 25% of the heart of old patients. And it's difficult to diagnose because extracardiac biopsies are often negative, and these older patients, they have very frequently monoclonal protein, up to 30% of cases in certain publication. The diagnosis is made by echo and MRI and negative genetic analysis for TTR mutation. And you must not give chemotherapy to these patients. To diagnose TTR amyloidosis, you have to do a DPD scan, like in this old patient, and there is a very important fixation on the earth, and it's peculiar for this form of amyloidosis is it could distinguish between AL amyloidosis and TTR amyloidosis. And what is the treatment? You can give green tea. You talked yesterday about the price of drugs. Green tea is 10 euros by month, and it could be efficient in this particular form of amyloidosis. So, type, you can use immunofluorescence on frozen tissues for AL, immunochemistry for AA and some hereditary forms. You can use immunoelectron microscopy, DNA analysis, and mass spectrometry when you have a problem to type the amyloidosis. And with these tools, you can describe a new form of amyloidosis as done by Sophie Valex for beta-2 and apolipoprotein C. And now I think there are 34 different proteins which can give amyloidosis. And it's everything is complicated in amyloidosis, and this publication reports about a family with an AL amyloidosis, an hereditary AL amyloidosis without any monoclonal light chain. It's not usual, I think it's the only family, and it's due to a mutation in the immunoglobulin kappa light chain constant region. So it's to keep in mind if you have a family with some cases of AL amyloidosis that is not hereditary at all usually. So you have done the diagnostic, you have typed the amyloidosis, and you have to be rapid to avoid this kind of survival curve. If you wait too long and the patient come with a severe heart disease, a stage 3 of the Mayo Clinic staging system, and the outcome is really bad. And it's difficult to diagnose amyloidosis because it can give many, many different presentations that I have not the time to detail. So how can you do a faster diagnosis? AL amyloidosis as myeloma is preceded by a period of monoclonal gammapathy like described in this paper. 85% of AL amyloidosis patients have an abnormal free light chain ratio at diagnosis. So patients with MGUS and abnormal free light chain ratio are at risk of developing AL amyloidosis. We have looked in our database and only 18 patients among 650 AL patients don't have elevated NT-proBNP and or proteinuria. So as proposed by Gianpaolo Merlini and Giovanni Palladini, I think that patients with MGUS and an abnormal free light chain ratio should have NT-proBNP and albuminuria measurement to detect an early organ involvement. And we have measured the NT-proBNP in 76 AL patients diagnosis and 67 MGUS patients, and that's clearly it's much more elevated in AL amyloidosis patient. And you have with a threshold around 300 nanogram per liter, a sensitivity of 80% and a specificity of 87% to diagnose amyloidosis among MGUS patients. So if the diagnostic is done, you have type the amyloidosis, you have to treat the patients, and it will depend on B-cell proliferation type. If it's plasma cell, you have to give a myeloma treatment. If other B-cell proliferation with an IgM, it's lymphoma or macroglobulinoma treatments. And flow cytometry, as in indicated in this paper, could help in characterizing the cells that are responsible for the production of the free light chain. So, if the treatment is efficient, involved organs are getting better, but most of the time very slowly, with different speed in different organs. The liver is relatively rapid, it's much more longer in the kidney, in the heart, or in macroglossia. And here you can see a patient with a hepatic involvement and with a very good hematologic response, we have a very good organ response. And you have to keep in mind that chemotherapy is not directly active on amyloid deposits.
So here's a timeline of treatment used since the 60s in AL amyloidosis, and it followed all the progress that have been made in myeloma. In the 60s, with MP, the response rate was 30%, and the survival, median survival of patients was 1.5 years. And things began to change with autologous stem cell transplantation, which double the response rates. But rapidly, we see that with malvalent and dexamethasone instead of prednisone, the response rate was not far from the one with autologous stem cell transplantation. And the best response rate was with bortezomib-containing regimen. And it's clear that in this disease, proteasome inhibitors are target drugs for AL amyloidosis due to the toxic effect of abnormal free light chain on the plasma cells. So you can, the first question is, what about autologous stem cell transplantation? Some years ago, we published this study comparing MDEX to high-dose treatment in AL amyloidosis in 100 patients, and we obtained a very better survival with MDEX, 56 months, than with autologous stem cell transplantation, 22 months. Is it still true 10 years after? We have looked with a follow-up for living patients at almost 12 years. And as you see, the curves are not really different. And when we do a landmark analysis, we take into account only patients surviving 6 months and who have received their allotted treatments. So with a TRM of 0% and a feasibility of 100%, the curves are really the same. And we have a look at the progression-free survival in the whole cohort and in the landmark analysis, and it's little bit, but it's not significant better with MDEX. And we have looked if many patients have developed myelodysplasia. It was only one in the autologous stem cell arm and two in the MDEX arm. So what is the percentage of patients receiving first line high-dose treatment now? It's 2% in Italy, it's less than 5% in the UK. In France, it's near 0%. And it's still 20% in Mayo Clinic, in Boston, in Heidelberg, in some centers. But it's for the 20% of patients who are good risk patients. And we have looked in our database with the guidelines that I will expose later on, what is the survival of patients who are who follow the criteria to be eligible for autologous stem cell transplantation as published by Moriguerz in 2013. And it was exactly 20% of our patients, 13 among 145. And here is the survival curve with a median follow-up of 4.7 years. So, as the COMy Congress is a congress on controversy, I will ask the question, is it really worth taking a 5 to 10% risk of dying within 100 days for a young, fit, low-risk patient with AL amyloidosis when you can have this survival curve with conventional treatment? So what is driving the prognosis in AL amyloidosis? It's cardiac involvement and it's DFLC, the difference between the involved field, the involved free light chain and the polyclonal free light chain. And we have three different staging systems. The classic Myo staging with NT-proBNP and troponin. When described as the European team with the same one and two stages, but 3E and 3B, depending on the value of NT-proBNP, and the new Myo staging with median NT-proBNP, DFLC, and troponin. And when we apply these three staging system to our cohorts, they work very well. And maybe the one who can describe the best this really bad patient is this one with a very high NT-proBNP. These patients are doing very, very bad. The second thing that is very important in amyloidosis is that survival is directly depending on hematologic response. The criteria have been described by a consensus between seven referral centers, and you have CR with excellent survival, no more free light chain. You have a VGPR, it's a DFLC below 40 milligrams per liter. PR, it's more than 50% of decrease, and all other patients are non-responder. And maybe the more important message of this talk, you have to look at the response, the hematologic response with the free light chain at each cycle. And you have to change the treatment if you have not a response. And you have to do that very quickly for severe patients. That is the curve in our database, the survival curve of refractory patients depending on myostaging. For stage one, you can wait. For stage two, you can wait, but not too long, but you can't wait to have a response if you want that your stage three patient survive. So it's the basis of our treatment in France since 2007. We stopped doing high-dose treatment after the result of the study. We then added bortezomib for non-responding patients after three cycles for patients without cardiac involvement, after one cycle for patients with cardiac involvement. And since 2011, we use a bortezomib-containing regimen, a VCD like Cyborg D, for myostage 3 patients with treatment not too long to avoid myelodysplasia. So here's the guidelines, and we try to obtain VGPR or better. And for IgM, it's the same structure, but we use rituximab and bendamustine plus bortezomib for non-responder. And interestingly, just some months ago, it has been shown that in L amyloidosis with IgM, there is the same mutation than in macroglobulinemia. So why not bortezomib for all patients? Because with MDEX, you can have in maybe 20% of patients this kind of very rapid and sustained response. So six cycles of MDEX, oral treatment, and 9 years after, the patient is still in complete response. And we have the first result of the international, the European study comparing MDEX and bortezomib index. And as you see, there is a little different, but it's not significant. And it appears after 10 months. So you can give MDEX for patients when they are not too severe. And you can add bortezomib in case of non-response, like in this patient with a heart involvement, no response after the first cycle, and you give bortezomib and you have a rapid response, and the NT-proBNP dropped, and the patient is the outcome is good. So we have looked in our database, and we have found 145 patients who were treated with this guideless in 27 centers. So myostage 1 and 2, MDEX first line and bortezomib rescue, and myostage 3, VCD first line. It's the median age was 67, and 42% of patients had more than 70 years of age. It's really a non-selected cohort with many patients with heart and kidney disease, and well balanced in the three stages. And in stage one, we add bortezomib in 42% of patients, in stage two, in 45%. And we can rescue 82% of patients who were refractory to MDEX adding bortezomib. And we have, for patients surviving at 6 months, 91% of response, and 62% of patients who reach VGPR or better. Here's a survival curve with a median follow-up for living patients of 42 years. The median survival is 5.6 years. And it's really depending on myostaging. It's more than 80% at 2 years for stage one and two, and it's only 50% in stage three. And when we look at the survival at 5 years, that means that we need a new treatment for this and these patients. And clearly we have made huge progress in this disease. It's the paper would describe the myostaging. It was in 2000, and the patient was mainly treated with MP, I think. And as you see, we have been from there to there, and it's clearly the survival is clearly better now. But for these patients, the patient 3B in the European classification with more than 8,500 nanogram of anti-proBNP, the outcome is really poor. You must give cardiac transplantation to this patient, but it's clearly an unmet medical need now. Maybe tetracycline could do something for patients with cardiac disease. It can reduce the rate of amyloid deposition, it can reduce the light chain toxicity, and it has been shown by the London team at the last ASH meeting that patients treated with doxycycline and bortezomib containing regimen have a better outcome than 67 control patients. Control patient was very well matched for the disease. I'm not sure that there were matches for the treatment. But clearly, doxycycline could maybe do something. And there will be a randomized study in Europe with doxycycline in patients with heart disease, and another one in France with doxycycline and or green tea in patients with cardiac AL amyloidosis. So for relapsed refractory patient, what we can do, we can use IMIDs, and with lenalidomide and pomalidomide, we can rescue patients. So if they don't respond to MDEX and to Velcade MDEX, to bortezomib MDEX, we can use IMIDs and new proteasome inhibitors. And one drug that may be very interesting in this disease is anti-CD38 antibodies, and we are going to begin a phase 2 monotherapy in France soon in patients not in VGPR after treatment. The new strategy are very, very promising. They try to accelerate deposit eliminations. So there are three monoclonal antibodies targeting amyloid. This one is only in phase one. This one, the NeoD1, that can maybe clear the oligomers for the blood and have a good action on the heart, is in phase three. It's a bortezomib containing regimen plus or minus NeoD, this antibody, and 50 patients have been included. And the phase two for patients already treated with a persistent cardiac dysfunction is going to begin soon. But maybe the most promising strategy is the one developed by Mark Pepys in London. They use a drug called CPHPC, who completely clear the SAP from the serum. The SAP is this protein with a high affinity for the fibrils. And once there is no more SAP in the serum, they give antibody against SAP, who bind on the fibril and recruit macrophage. And there is a very rapid elimination of amyloid in the liver. It's clear it works in the liver, as shown in this SAP scintigraphy. We don't know yet if it works well in the heart and in the kidney, and the phase two is ongoing in London. So in conclusion, diagnostics must be done before severe heart involvement. You have to type amyloidosis. You have to tailor your treatment with severity and most importantly, the hematologic response. We have to find innovative treatment for severe Mayo stage 3, and I think that really a new era in amyloidosis is open with treatment aimed to eliminate deposits. So for the French speaking here, here is our website. Thanks to all members of the French network for AL amyloidosis, and see you, I hope, in Uppsala in July. Thank you for your attention.